We all know the M8 is a big grand tour with an M badge, but this one's got some supercar touches. It's got carbon ceramic brakes, and inside it's got carbon fiber bucket seats. What is going on here? Well, let's find out. Buckle up and let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Makse, racer, lover of driving fast, fun things, and on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, in 2024, the BMW M8 competition might be a bit of an anachronism, especially when everything is going hybrid and EV. This one is still powered by a good old big turbocharged V8, but it is also equipped with some funny things like these carbon fiber buckets and carbon ceramic brakes. Now, I love carbon ceramic brakes, but we'll get into that in a little bit. And before we get into what this car is like to drive, let's have a look at it in a little more depth. This M8 competition gets the full M treatment and more, particularly with this car, and it starts with that 4.4 liter twin turbo V8 under the hood. It makes, you ready for this, 617 horsepower at 6,000 RPM and 553 pounds of torque from 1,800 to 5,860 RPM. Transmission is an 8-speed automatic. There is an M-tuned all-wheel drive system, which also means it is switchable from all-wheel drive to rear-wheel drive. It also gets the active M differential, which is an electronically controlled limited slip diff, which is also modern day magic. Suspension's based around double wishbones at the front, 5-link at the rear, adaptive dampers. The steering has a funny M name, but what it really means is it's variable ratio, variable assist. This one has the optional massive carbon ceramic brakes with 6-piston calipers at the front, single piston at the rear, and it's brake by wire. Wheels and tires are 20s. The rubber is a set of Michelin Pilot Sports that are non-run flat. And curb weight of this M8 competition is 4,354 pounds. Did you know that about 80% of you are not subscribed? Yes, it's true. I checked the data and 80% of you are not subscribed. So if you enjoy the content on this channel, do me a solid, hit that subscribe button. While you're at it, be sure to like this video and share it. And if you don't mind, drop by our merch store. There's lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Now back to your regularly scheduled episode. The thing about these seats is that they compromise ingress and egress because you've got such a low roof line here. So you kind of got to contort yourself when you get in and out of this thing, as do your passengers who may or may not appreciate the same kind of driving experience that you do, but that's another story. Nonetheless, once you're here, you're perfectly situated and supportive. I've got a great relationship to the steering wheel and to the pedals, and I'm just set up perfectly as a driver, as BMW knows how to do. However, in context of this being a grand tour, not a hardcore sports car like the M4 CSL, I just think these seats are out of character with this car. It's cool that they make them optional, but I would never spec my M8 with these seats. The steering wheel is just the right shape, the right size. It's shaped to encourage you to have your hands at 9 and 3. And then, of course, you got all this extra stuff on it. But the most important things are the shift paddles and your M1 and M2 configurable drive mode buttons. Ergonomically, this is not latest generation BMW, so you don't have the latest big screen, big dual screen setup. You do have two separate screens, and they're both digital. They're extremely legible, but this doesn't have BMW's latest infotainment system, which is just fine with me because I really don't use it all that much. All I want to do is play with Sirius XM from time to time and otherwise be happy with my Apple CarPlay, and this does a great job of rendering the Apple CarPlay on the screen. Very happy with that. Otherwise, not terribly interested in the infotainment system, although this Bowers & Wilkins sound system is fantastic. Ergonomically, it's pretty straightforward. The climate controls are here, not built into the screen, because again, it's not the latest system. And the iDrive controller is very familiar to all of us who are familiar with BMWs. And I do love this BMWM shifter. It just adds a little bit of a sense of occasion because it's so different than every other kind of shifter. I would like a little bit more of a mechanical feel to it. I'm sure I've said that before in previous episodes, but I really like this M shifter. In terms of spaciousness, well, You got it up here in this row, you and your passenger, lots of room, save for the fact that these seats hold you in nice and tight. But then that second row, I cannot fit behind myself in the seating position. And as many of you know, I sit close to the steering wheel. Not a chance I could fit back there at all. Where there is an abundance of room is in the trunk. And surprise, surprise, I used the split folding rear seats the other day to carry a snowboard in this thing. Yes, indeed, and it was easy to do. Given the fact that this thing has all-wheel drive, this could be an all-weather Grand Tour for this part of the world. Just put some meaty snow tires on it, and I think you could run it all four seasons, especially in some deep snow, and really enjoy yourself, especially since this is switchable to rear-wheel drive. Last word about this interior, I love this Alcantara on the dash. It's really turning me into a dash stroker. Not just kidding. This interior is definitely on par with what Bentley does. Their interiors are very elegant with a lot of detail, and I think that's where BMW has gone with this. This is a gorgeous, gorgeous interior. It's extremely well finished. It's been a while since I've driven something this quick. Like, this is ridiculous. BMW says 0 to 60 in 3.2. I am sure that some people on the right road surface have done 0 to 60 in under 3 seconds. This is ridiculously quick. It also speaks to the fact that this does have an electronically controlled limited slip diff, and the all-wheel drive system has been massaged and refined by M, so it's putting every single horse to work in getting that power down to the ground. We have to keep in mind that this does say M8 on the outside. It doesn't say M850, so it really is honed and refined by M to do exactly what it's meant to do. In terms of that drivetrain, well, the V8 makes 617 horsepower, and that is just incredible. And it makes it up near redline, so the more you run this to redline, the more rewarding it is, but then it makes peak torque through the fattest part of the rev range. So you've got maximum torque any time you need it, and that is actually suited to the character of this car, which is really a Grand Tour. So with that big, massive amount of torque available almost everywhere in the rev range, it's just an easy, laid-back driving experience when you want it to be, and then when you want to get the maximum acceleration out of this thing, well, you just mat that throttle pedal, and this thing rockets everywhere in a straight line, also rockets out of corners, which we'll talk about in a little bit. Especially when you start messing with the drive modes, use the M1 or M2, configure it to your liking, the transmission changes its behavior as well, so the gearbox will actually drive like a proper gearbox in an M car. So it'll hold gears all the way to redline. It shifts quickly both up and down the box. It does rev match downshifts. And then when you're cruising, it just shifts smoothly and imperceptibly. It's kind of best of both worlds. Let's talk about the E-diff for just a second. These things are magic. The reason they're magic is they are fully variable. They constantly adjust the amount of lock depending on what the car needs, and it uses various systems to tell the diff what it needs. And then under braking, it's fully open so that the car is more stable under braking and you have more confidence in your ability to slow this down under aggressive braking when you're hitting that brake pedal. It's just a magical bit of technology, and no mechanical limited slip diff can duplicate it. As we've seen in other M cars, whenever the M division at BMW is let loose on these things, they tend to take them to the extreme. And in this case, the all-wheel drive system is simply flawless. It does exactly what I want it to do when I want it to do it. And then, of course, it's switchable. So you can switch this all-wheel drive system to rear-wheel drive, which is just brilliant. Changes the complete attitude of the car. But this is a proper M car in that regard. The thing is, because when you let the car do the work and distribute torque to each of the wheels the way it wants to, it behaves absolutely flawlessly. It is incredible what this big beast of a Grand Tourer is capable of doing, especially when exiting corners. I mean, it's over 4,300 pounds, and you still have incredible confidence when you step on the gas pedal of this thing. Plus, BMW hasn't hidden the fact that this has a V8. That V8 rumble is always present, and of course it has the switchable exhaust, so you can turn this switch on so you get a little extra sound on the outside. That's cool and all, but I really love the way this pops and burbles on downshifts. Ah, yeah, sounds so good. In terms of this M8's overall dynamics, there's just one thing I have to say. It can make anyone look like a hero, and that's because it's such a well-resolved package in terms of how it puts down power, but also in terms of how it handles. It's so cohesive as a car that it's just incredible. In terms of handling, starts with the steering. It is a big car, so you're not really getting a lot of feel from the steering wheel itself. You do get a lot of feel from the chassis, which is a good thing. The fact that these seats are here and are basically here to keep you directly connected with the chassis are one of the reasons why you get great chassis feedback from this M8, but not a lot of feel or feedback that comes from the steering wheel. Now, on the other hand, I was hoping that this brake system would have communicated like the M3s, M4s, and I think even the M2 is brake-by-wire. This brake-by-wire system doesn't seem to have a lot of feel or feedback, and again, I do have to say one thing with respect to the fact that you can change the level of brake assist. No, you're not changing brake feel, you're changing the level of brake assist. I set it to its firmest, I think it's sport or whatever, and that's the way it should be, especially in an ultra high performance car like this M8. But I don't get a sense that there's any difference between the two levels of brake assist, and on top of that, there's not a lot of feel or feedback. So I am relying on a lot of chassis feel when I'm into that brake pedal, and the brakes are incredibly strong. Even with the sense that there's a little bit less brake feel here, these brakes are simply incredible. And because I can feel what's going on through the chassis, control, modulation, and power are all 10s out of 10 for me. These carbon ceramics deliver on a number of fronts, and more so than a conventional brake setup. First, they are more thermally efficient than a traditional brake setup, that's for sure. There's no question about that. And these last an incredibly long time, especially if you intend to abuse them on the racetrack. On day-to-day driving, especially when you're throwing it around the corners, these carbon ceramics weigh less, so they allow the dampers to do a better job in terms of keeping the tires in contact with the road. That is so important. It's a big car, and they have done an excellent job tuning these dampers. They just work exceptionally well. And how's the ride over a railroad crossing? Wow, that was ridiculously smooth. What I'm also impressed with is the overall balance of this chassis. It is very, very neutral. And even when you pick up the throttle, the all-wheel drive system is so tuned. You're exiting a corner, pick up the throttle. This thing does not want to understeer. It is very, very neutral. It makes everyone look like a hero in almost every situation. You have such tremendous confidence when you're behind the wheel of this M8 and piloting it. It does everything that you want it to do. And in terms of putting down that power, the all-wheel drive system puts all of it down so flawlessly, and it's just real world quick. I think on the open road, it just soaks up the miles, eats up the miles, no trouble at all. And this is just an incredible Grand Tour with a whole lot of M-derived attitude.
How do you spec yours? Well, this is an interesting question to answer, especially in context of this car. What you are looking at is Marina Bay Blue Metallic and the black and beige interior with a whole lot of Alcantara all over the interior. Now, some notable options on this one, as you know, are the carbon ceramics and the carbon fiber bucket seats. And at first glance, that doesn't quite make a lot of sense. The brakes are $8,500 US or almost $11,000 Canadian. The seats are about $3,400 US or $6,500 Canadian. In addition to the brakes and the seats, this one may have every possible option on the list. Base price in the US is $138,800, and as tested, it's $163,000 US. In Canada, base price is $160,500, and as tested, $187,150. Now, in terms of speccing yours, I'm absolutely loving the carbon ceramic brakes, as you know, love the braking system on this car. However, those carbon fiber buckets, I could definitely do without. The funny thing is, given the amount of performance and lateral G's this car is capable of generating, the seats do make a lot of sense, but in day-to-day use, they're very much out of character. I think you and any passengers you'd have in your M8 would get annoyed with those seats fairly quickly. I highly recommend the standard buckets, but for novelty, for someone who gets to enjoy this car for a week, they're absolutely a blast. But no, I highly recommend you get your M8 with the standard seats. My verdict? Well, I gotta say it's been a real treat to spend some quality time with this brilliant Grand Tour. Now, not a fan of the carbon fiber buckets in this big GT, but otherwise, this thing is incredibly well sorted. There are few compromises, few faults of this car. It is nearly brilliant all around, and the thing is, car makers aren't going to be making these things much more. So if you're looking for a Grand Tour, definitely two-person coupe-like experience and want some serious performance to go along with it, you absolutely need to check out the M8 Competition. There's not much like it in the market now. There's certainly not going to be much like it in the future, but this thing is a proper special piece, and the M badge is absolutely legit on this M8 Competition. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2024 BMW M8 Competition with these interesting carbon fiber deep buckets. Anyway, hope you liked this episode, and if you did, you're not new to YouTube, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring, so please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please hit up the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can, and if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below, lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even BMW M8 competitions.